Good afternoon, everybody. I really would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to participate in this very interactive workshop. It's as much a part of imparting knowledge as a learning process. And now I would be speaking on premature ovarian failure, as this workshop is all about how we exclude other conditions which masquerade as PCOS. So one of the conditions which we don't normally associate with PCOS is premature ovarian failure. But let us just see how they can be interlinked and how it can be confusing the diagnosis. So we know that PCOS is a classical triad of oligomenorrhea, hyperandrogenism, and polycystic ovarian morphology of ovaries. But whatever classification we follow, it always comes with this clause that it is after excluding certain endocrine conditions. And the common conditions we think of have all been elucidated in the previous session. That is either various causes of hyperandrogenism, Cushing's, or other causes of oligomenorrhea such as hypo or hyperthyroidism and hyperprolactinemia. Premature ovarian failure is not included as an exclusion criteria routinely, but has certain clinical, important clinical implications. So what are these links? I mean, we are talking about PCOS, which is a normogonadotrophic condition, and premature ovarian failure, which is a hyper gonadotrophic condition. But at certain point of time, in the timeline of evolving premature ovarian failure, there could be a common denominator where there is oligoamenorrhea kind of a picture, which can be confusing. We know that premature ovarian failure, we call it premature ovarian failure when menopause occurs below the age of 40 years, and that is the onset of amenorrhea. But as I just mentioned, there could be a preceding period of oligomenorrhea where in young women it can be confused with PCOS. And these women tend to have well-developed secondary sexual characteristics if the onset is post-pubertal. And also when it happens in very young women, if they're in their late teens or early 20s, there could be some acne, a little bit of hirsutism, which can all confuse the scenario to be that of PCOS instead of premature ovarian failure, purely on clinical assessment. And if we do put them through further evaluation in early stages, these girls may still have normal basal FSH levels, and elevated LH doesn't point either way. You know, it could be part of PCOS or it could be reflecting premature ovarian failure. And what about the ultrasound as a diagnostic tool? We know that these two ovaries, these two ovaries look very, very distinct from each other. First one is polycystic ovarian morphology, and the second one looks very quiescent. But we know that according to Rotterdam criteria, presence of PCO morphology is one of the criteria, but it is not an essential criteria for diagnosis of PCOS. So if you just see a fairly quiescent ovary on the ultrasound, it doesn't exclude PCOS. So here comes the role of AMH as a very robust diagnostic tool to distinguish between various conditions, that is healthy population, women with PCOS, functional hypothalamic and amenorrhea, and premature ovarian failure. So measurement of AMH actually gives information on ovarian reserve when women with secondary amenorrhea are investigated. Women with PCOS, as we all agree, will exhibit very high levels of AMH, whereas AMH is almost undetectable in those with premature ovarian failure, and whereas women with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea will have normal serum AMH levels similar to that of healthy controls. In addition to these clinical issues, academically, there has been a lot of interest to see whether PCOS and premature ovarian failure actually reflect two extremes of same genetic abnormalities. And there has been a lot of work done in various people from various ethnicities in this regard. Various receptor gene mutations have been evaluated, like upregulation and downregulation of certain genes, whether it can lead to one or the other of the manifestations. Also, dysregulation of intra-ovarian signaling has been evaluated. And of course, we cannot forget iatrogenic factor. I'll just go through that first of all. I mean, this is something, you know, which we should never ever be inflicting on our patients. Those with proven PCOS undergoing ovarian drilling or ovarian wedge resection indiscriminately, you know, leading to destruction of ovarian tissue can eventually lead to premature onset of ovarian failure. And this is something none of us should ever be facing. Neither our patients should be facing it, nor should we be doing this. So we must really be very careful in choosing patients for ovarian drilling and follow the standard rules rather than being overzealous about it. But coming back to genuine connections between PCOS and POF, various FSH receptor gene mutations have been studied for PCOS and premature ovarian failure in Malaysians, Singaporeans, Chinese, Japanese, Caucasians, and in none of these ethnicities, there has been a proven link between various FSH receptor mutations, gene mutations, and occurrence of PCOS or premature ovarian failure. So that doesn't seem to be playing an etiological role here. But recently, there has been some interest in the androgen receptor dysfunction. We know that PCOS is associated with hyperandrogenism, and there is some dysregulation of genes dealing with androgen receptors. But what has been found in animal studies, not yet proven in human studies, but in animal studies, is that inactivation of androgen receptors in female mice leads to premature ovarian failure, indicating that normal folliculogenesis requires androgen receptor mediated androgen action. So if it goes towards one side, it will lead to PCOS, but inactivation on the other side can lead to premature ovarian failure. So I mean, until recently, as clinicians, we don't think of these two as two ends of the same spectrum, but they appear to have some common linkage as far as etiology is concerned. When there is doubt as to what we are dealing with, especially in young girls where a complete assessment through ultrasound may not be possible, one of the rescuing factors is doing karyotype, which will diagnose or rule out Turner's or Turner mosaics, more so Turner mosaics. It's very important. And if that is ruled out, then it is very important to consider in those with hypergonadotrophic hypogonadism to do a FMR1 DNA analysis, because that is the commonest cause beyond Turner's and Turner mosaics for premature ovarian failure. And also it helps to distinguish it from PCOS. What about the intra-ovarian mechanisms which can be either leading to PCOS or to premature ovarian failure? We know that this primordial follicle pool, which is incessantly going through atresia from fetal life to menopause, is influenced by various autocrine, paracrine, and hormonal factors. And follicular atresia, sort of from around 6 months of gestation, it's a non-cyclical, non-gonadotropic dependent, unremitting process of atresia, which takes place throughout this girl's life. And this process results in what is believed to be an irreversible attrition of the primordial pool. By the onset of puberty, around 95% of these follicles are lost, and about 400 of the remaining follicles will eventually lead to ovulation, whereas remaining ones will go through post-pubertal atresia, which is a tonic lifelong process which leads to ovulation of a small number of ovulation in small number of follicles and atresia of the remaining follicles. And here is the role of AMH. AMH binds to the AMH receptor type 2 and has an inhibitory effect on the follicle growth by decreasing the sensitivity of the ovarian follicles to FSH. Thus, it prevents loss of oocyte pool by slowing down recruitment of the follicles from primordial pool to the growing pool. So it has a very important role in controlling the follicular rate of follicular atresia from puberty to menopause. So AMH is a key regulator, as we know of today, which inhibits the default mode of atresia from occurring. And in women with PCOS, high AMH and the rate of decline is slower than non-PCOS women, which was being discussed a little while ago. This leads to slower exhaustion of the primordial pool, and follicular atresia increases with age as AMH declines. Interestingly, in those AMH knockout mice, where artificially the AMH gene is knocked out, they have accelerated follicular atresia compared to wild type of mice. So the fact that AMH is produced by the pool of growing follicles to act as a negative paracrine feedback signal on the primordial follicle pool leads to the strengthens the hypothesis that AMH may function as an anti-atritic agent. So consequently, those who do not have adequate level of AMH will exhaust their follicles very early on. There is another clinical scenario which is quite confusing. We have diagnosed a lady as having PCOS following all the international norms, and we put her through various stages of stimulation and she doesn't stimulate well. So she is often referred to as poor ovarian responder. She's PCOS but poor ovarian responder. I don't think we should be confusing that situation with true poor ovarian response or premature ovarian failure. These women with diagnosed PCOS but who are resistant to most of the forms of stimulation are amenable to various clinical manipulations individually or when put together, like intense lifestyle modification, addition of metformin, laparoscopic ovarian drilling done judiciously, maybe myonisitol, and putting them through stimulation strategies involving high doses of gonadotropin, or if all fails, then in vitro maturation through IVF cycles will lead to retrieval of reasonable number of oocytes. But this is not the case with premature ovarian failure or the preceding case of premature ovarian, poor ovarian reserve, where the ovarian follicular pool is almost completely or completely depleted and egg donation is the only practical option available for such women. The future, can we do anything about these situations? Probably yes. There is so much of work being done on AMH. We are probably in the process of developing AMH antagonists, which will help to treat PCOS, and also AMH agonists for the management of premature ovarian failure, both of which will regulate the rate of follicular atresia and lead to discernible ovarian function in both these extremes of the situation. So to conclude, PCOS and POF both may present with oligo or amenorrhea. They both may share common genetic aberrations. Endocrine evaluation, particularly AMH, is a very important diagnostic tool, and correct diagnosis is important for appropriate clinical management. And in future, we may have tools to manipulate ovarian reserve. Thank you.
Can I take questions?
I'll
be leaving now.
Okay.
So I've finished early.
Okay, we can have the questions right now as ma'am has to leave. So any questions for her?
Okay, so if the audience doesn't have...
Ma'am, I have one case. She is young female, around 24 years old, and very low AMH and with obesity. Initially, I diagnosed her as a case of PCOS, but on investigation, AMH was very less, FHS high, so she was a case of poor ovarian reserve. Now, my question is, if I want to rule out Turner's, a simple karyotype will help, or some specific test on karyotyping will diagnose?
If you want to rule out Turner's, simple karyotype will help. But for further academic interest, if her karyotype is normal, then you can look for FMR gene mutations.
Okay, and which test will help me in diagnosing, what should I advise?
There is a DNA analysis specifically done for FMR gene mutation, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. I know, wanted to know your experience when there is low enteral follicular count and poor ovarian AMH around 1. So what is the role of ovarian rejuvenating drugs supposed to be?
Such as
how long, whether with the fertility treatment continued, all these three.
I mean, one of the most important thing is if such a person desires fertility, irrespective of her age, we should expedite the treatment. She should be fast-tracked as far as fertility treatment is concerned, along with whatever lifestyle modification is required. If she's obese, you know, like, I mean, parallelly, losing whatever strategies to help her lose weight should continue. And maybe, I mean, there is some evidence that vitamin D will help them. I'm just saying, these are the factors we need to look into. And see, one of the most widely used drug is DHEA. And from our clinic, we have published a paper showing some improvement in the quality of the oocyte. I mean, none of these can improve the ovarian reserve. We have to be very clear that there is no known strategy will increase the number of oocytes. It may help in improving the intra-ovarian environment. I mean, my personal opinion is that as long as we do not delay the actual treatment, none of these steps are to replace the mainline treatment. Parallelly, I don't see any harm in putting them through that. If you are talking about DHEA, there is evidence. I mean, there are other papers which have shown that as short as 4 weeks is sufficient. So I think by putting them on DHEA for 4 weeks, we are certainly not delaying the treatment, because practically speaking, nobody is going to, you know, come today and start the treatment tomorrow. So that seems to be fine.
Are there any papers with the other supplements also? All
I mean, as long as we do not go overboard and put them on, you know, like. I think there has been, you know, like work going
Not
on about it,
going
on about
going
it,
on.
But there is no series as such which has been published. I mean, people have identified presence of these precursor stem cells in the ovary, and I mean, in animal models, they have actually been able to stimulate them through various strategies. But in humans, like being treated and a case series, I do not think has been published so
Ma'am,
far.
Ma'am, one question. If a female around 28 years age, complaining of amenorrhea for 5 years, 6 years, so like her, she's a case of premature ovarian failure. So like, do we have to give withdrawal or we should explain the patient and leave it at such?
See, there are two issues here. One is fertility for her and her general health. So I think it is generally accepted that they should have they should get estrogen progesterone replacement for the general health purpose. But if we are taking them through egg donation, for example, it still is important that at least they get 3 to 4 cycles of withdrawal to improve the uterine
so
perfusion.
Ma'am, if she is not willing for she's already have 2-3 children, then
I mean, then for her general health, at least until the age of 40 she should receive.
Every like 3 months or like how many months? How frequent we have to give withdrawal?
Sorry?
How frequently we have to give withdrawal?
We'll give her cyclical estrogen progesterone.
Cyclically.
Yeah.
Till 40 years?
Till 40 years. I think now there is a very recent paper which says simple OCP is as good as estradiol, valerate and progesterone.
Ma'am, please take
I mean, that's what I was telling. You know, HRT and OCP seem to be providing the same level of benefit in these. There's a very recent paper with fairly large numbers saying that it doesn't matter which one we use. Yeah.
Also, just to wind up, Dr. Padma, if you could give the practical guidelines for the hall, that when exactly to take up the patients for ovarian drilling, because that's a big cause for leading them to be OIF.
Yeah, I mean, if so we go by the textbook description, it is lean PCOS who have high basal LH, who are clomiphene citrate resistant. Now we may say clomiphene and letrozole resistant. And to be on the safer side, I would add metformin. And if they have not ovulated with that, these are the, and
so
those.
How long do they need to wait? And when do we say that they are resistant?
Clomiphene resistant is if they have not responded to 100 milligram ovarian stimulation with 100 milligram of clomiphene citrate, and for letrozole maybe 5 milligram. So, but I would, you know, I would still say try adding metformin and see if she's relatively young. And if that fails, then go for...
Just restricted to a very small subset of the group which you would be taking.
Yeah. And other factors come in where somebody who cannot come for routine follow-up, you know, stays far away and cannot be trusted to be coming regularly for follow-up, for repeated ovulation induction. So that is another subset where we may have to selectively decide. And now that we have AMH, we should really have the documentation that they have abnormally high AMH. That is what, you know, like we have all been traditionally trained.
Recently, we had the guidelines on premature ovarian failure, and in that also, we went through all the literature and still.
Just, you know, in this month, I'm forgetting the journal, but there is a large study which has been published saying that for all the necessary bone and cardiac protection up to 40.
Ma'am, according to ASHRAE SRM guideline 2015, beta estradiol can be given. And that is the best one for
Dr. Padma. Do we have the guidelines or some data on annual decrease in the AMH values annually?
I think it decreases in normal healthy individuals. The average rate is about 0.16 nanogram per ml per year.
Okay.
It's a very small decline.
I had read that 0.2 nanogram per
years of age.
0.2 nanogram per year.
So 0.16
can be the during counseling we can. And any studies done on PCOS patients where they waited for AMH to decline and then did the?
I think a very important message with PCOS is that the the AMH can be high, but the fertility window is not extended. In PCOS. So they should be treated, as far as fertility is concerned, they should be treated with the same speed as anybody else. We should not, you know, like, because age will start having its impact.
So, okay. Thank you.